Chidambaram, who was arrested earlier today by the CBI for his alleged involvement in the INX Media case, has been sent to today's police custody. Son of former Finance Minister P Chidambaram, Karti, was arrested at the Chennai airport after he returned from London. The CBI had filed its FIR in the case last year. It had alleged that there were irregularities in the erstwhile Foreign Investment Promotion Board's clearance to INX Media for receiving overseas funds to the tune of 350 crore rupees in 2007 when P Chidambaram was the Finance Minister. The FIR also alleged that INX Media had paid 10 lakh rupees to Karti's firm as consultancy fee. Let's get an exclusive interview. Abhishek Manu Singhvi is joining in and we have Ashmit Kumar to take us through that exclusive interview. Ashmit, over to you.
Mr. Singhvi, a pleasure speaking to you this evening. Good evening to you. We were there in the courtroom. We saw the arguments being made there. And one of the key arguments that you had made in defense of Karti Chidambaram while seeking bail was that it's ironic that CBI, on one hand, alleges non-cooperation, alleges flight risk, but at the same time, the arrest is made as Karti Chidambaram is flying back into the country. As you had said, he is not a Hindustan leaver. Does this arrest now and the dramatic action taken by the CBI perhaps raise questions about the timings and the motivations?
Well, Ashwath, I didn't know you were in court, but let me start by giving you the premises of this interview. I am not speaking in political role. I am not speaking on the merits. I am not speaking on the judgment. I am a counsel in the case. I've just come from court. I argued for a long time. All that I will do is summarize my submissions. You can make what you want to make of them. And that is the fair way of commenting, otherwise I'm not getting into the merits at all. As you know, personally, but as your viewers don't know, the first and foremost argument was that 28th of August last year was the last time the CBI sent me a summons. They'd sent me one before that. On both the summons I appeared and I gave full cooperation for almost 20, 25, 30 hours of interrogation. Now the remarkable thing about this case is this is a submission, it's not an appeal against an order, it's not a criticism of the order, it's not a comment on the order at all. I think we were heard with great interest and respect, and an order which is passed is only till tomorrow 12:30. But consider, Ashmit, that you don't have any questions for me for 6 months. Today is the 6 month anniversary of the last date when the CBI called me. And I land up from abroad and you arrest me. We are now talking not the merits, we're talking of the arrest. What is the necessity of arrest if you don't need the need to question me for the last 6 months? Number two, I am under Supreme Court and High Court orders, two of them, traveled abroad for 10 days each on different dates, twice, roughly 20, 25 days. Each time I gave them time, flight, details, stay, and returned on the relevant time stipulated, dot, no violation. Is it not ironic that the reward for coming back on time as a law-abiding citizen is arrest? Number three submission I made was that the funny part is under law, under judgments, under Article 22 of the Constitution, you have to give me a ground of arrest. Have you given a ground of arrest? Answer is no. No ground of arrest. Then, of course, the submission was that this is a 10-year-old offense. The only tests for arrest are, as we all understand, either flight risk or tampering with evidence or non-cooperation interrogation. The test of non-cooperation does not arise if you don't call me and I don't come. You have to test my non-cooperation by calling me. The test of flight risk doesn't apply because I've come back each time. The test of tampering is absolutely bereft of a single detail, not one detail. Then what are they wanting the arrest and remand for? You see, Article 21 is the life and liberty of an accused. The power of arrest, as the Supreme Court has said, and we argued this, is different from the exercise of that power. Merely because you have the power to impose death penalty does not mean you impose death penalty. Now you need to think about what considerations require, and today I would say this. At the end of the day, whatever we do tomorrow, the judge has allowed them till 12:30 on a 10-year-old charge, which, by the way, Ashwit, had Mr. Subba Rao as chairman of the FIPB, six secretaries of government of India, none of them interrogated even. Not one of them interrogated. The payment of 10 lakhs is to a company called Advantage Strategic, which he has been, Karti Chidambaram, never, I repeat, never been a director or a shareholder. Now, and it's paid by check with TDS. That's the bribery charge.
Fair enough.
Now, on this,
fair enough.
If you have to do all this, then at the most you have time till tomorrow. You can interrogate him all night, all morning. There can't be more questions you have to ask after 10 years. and having had him for last 1 year on an FIR. And by the way, apart from this interrogation for the same issue, I've been interrogated for 36, 40 hours with the ED also. So I think there has to be a rule of law and safeguards. And I think that is where this case is.
Fair enough.
Okay.
Mr. Singhvi, allow me to play the devil's advocate here. As you said, for the 1 hour, he will be available. He will be at the disposal of the CBI for questioning. Allow me to play just the devil's advocate here. They did raise the questions of how perhaps there has been non-cooperation in terms of non-compliance with the Madras High Court order conditions, which is a detailed itinerary of travel and an undertaking that he will be appearing, that Karti Chidambaram will be appearing before the CBI. Those conditions have not been met. Is that a valid grounds for arrest? Does that raise questions about perhaps possible non-compliance and hence the allegation of non-cooperation?
You were there in court, but you missed out. Ashwit, you were there in court, but you missed out because you're not a lawyer. Number one, this argument was raised after I'd finished the arguments by the CBI prosecutor. We immediately produced the affidavit filed in the High Court and the letter receipted by the CBI where we said that we have complied with all the conditions. What more do you want? Number two, when I showed that, the CBI prosecutor said to the court, this is not a ground for remand. I'm only pointing it out. Now I'll give you something more interesting. They have not mentioned anywhere, but they showed papers to say that they have recorded somebody's statement in February. Now, if you have, as alleged, recorded some Mukherjee statement, this is what is alleged, I don't know, we are not given these details, either husband or wife, you have to be only picking up a book, even as a layman, and tell your viewers this. I'm only repeating what I've argued, I'm not going into the merits. The submission was from our side that section 25 and 26 of the Evidence Act is very clear that if you are in custody for 2 years, that too on a murder charge, and somebody records a statement, that statement is completely inadmissible. The statement of a person in custody is completely inadmissible. So these are the only grounds that they're trying to juggle grounds, they're trying to desperately find grounds, whereas the application of remand didn't say anything of this sort.
Fair enough. Mr. Singhvi, one last question. I'll just take 2 more minutes of your time. This question about with respect to timing, it does happen to be, as you said in the court, that this arrest is most bizarre, the way it has been done, that the mere existence of power need not be the same as the exercise of power of arrest. With that in mind, does this perhaps raise questions about other motivations behind the timing, given that it does take the focus away from another major issue that we had been tracking for the last few days?
I have a lot to say, as you know, but since I'm appearing in this matter, I am neither speaking in my political role nor speaking on the merits in terms of the comment. I'm restraining myself. Prior to appearing, I had tweeted many things. You have them on tweets. But now that I'm appearing, I'm not going to discuss that part, of which a lot can be said. Thank you so much.
Deeply appreciate your time, Mr. Singhvi. Appreciate your thoughts there. So that was, of course, the counsel for Mr. Karti Chidambaram, Mr. Abhishek Manu Singhvi, clarifying that this indeed is a case of arrest which is most bizarre, not wanting to comment on issues beyond just the arrest that has taken place. But again, for the benefit of our viewers, just to reiterate here as to what is the fallout of today's actions. Well, after the arrest in the morning, the Patiala House Court, after lengthy hearings this evening, I was there in person, has thought it fit to give 1 day's police custody to the CBI. And this is, again, a far cry from what the CBI had sought. The CBI was seeking 15 days remand, 15 days police custody is the demand that they had put forth. For now, it's 1 day police custody. What that effectively means is that as of right now, the CBI will be, Karti Chidambaram will be at the mercy, will be at the disposal of the CBI. They will be grilling him over the night. But this permission, this remand, so to speak, lasts only till about 12:30, as Mr. Singhvi said, till tomorrow. Before 2:30, Karti Chidambaram will have to appear again before the special court. And that's again where we will see Karti Chidambaram's counsel pushing for bail while the CBI seeks an extension for that remand. So the action continues. We, of course, will get you all those details as the action unfolds tomorrow. But that's all.